So welcome today to the Sleep Advocacy Forum. This is a new event to bring together a powerful group of you guys. You are key leaders and patient advocates, and we are here to learn from each other and to look for opportunities to maximize our collective impact and to elevate our national profile for the entire sleep community. We have an amazing group joining us today and an incredible lineup of speakers. And please just know that today's sessions are educational and they will cover an array of healthcare topics important to sleep, circadian, and sleep disorder communities. We will hear timely updates on recent challenges and emerging opportunities in medical research, treatment development, public health, and patient care from leading policy experts and organizations. So who is participating today? Who are these amazing people that are joining us in the Zoom world? Well, we have quite a group of people from policymakers and funders of biomedical research to biomedical researchers themselves, along with treatment developers and regulators and clinicians, and also patients and sleep advocates. So I just want to, I both love graphs like these, but I also always worry that it makes us feel like we're all silos or something. But in truth, I just want to remind everyone that each of us is experts in our own area, and we each have something to really contribute to this group. And with that, I also want to remind us that we each kind of have insider language. Policy has insider language. Patients have insider language. Doctors, researchers. So there will be a lot of information coming today, and sometimes there's a lot of acronyms and names of things that you might not be familiar with, and that's okay. That doesn't mean you don't belong here. We all belong here. We're all just learning together. Promise me. I have been doing this for a while, and I still feel like I'm learning every day. So, and each of us also have a story of what got us here today. And I'm just going to share a brief bit about what brought me here today. So my journey to this day, I like to say it started with about 14 years ago when I was in law school, and I had been diagnosed with a serious case of narcolepsy with cataplexy at the beginning of my second year of law school. And I started treatment, which was improving my symptoms, but certainly hadn't erased my symptoms. And it was a few months after starting these treatments that I made a really surprising discovery. So you guys know I'm a storyteller. I love stories. And I will thank you for indulging me in reading a brief passage from my memoir that describes this discovery that I made. One night while studying at a group table in the library, I looked at the clock to see it was past 9 p.m. And I realized that I hadn't taken a nap yet. Usually by this hour, my daytime stimulant had worn off and I'd already thrashed in and out of fogginess at least a few times, taking a nap or two, or fighting off the excruciating heaviness. This night, there was absolutely no heaviness pushing down on my skull. No clogged connections in my brain, no nagging at my eyelids. The feeling of nothing would usually go undetected, but it was so foreign to me that nothing felt like something. In the hushed silence of the law library, tears streamed down my cheeks and fell into the crease of my textbook. I didn't bother to hide my face or wipe my tears. Instead, I sat still in awe of this strange self-realization. The gap between wakefulness and sleepiness was much wider than I thought. I'd lost touch entirely with what true wakefulness felt like. I saw it now as powerful because it was so free. I could think and study and make connections without any heaviness on my head. I truly believe that wakefulness is a form of freedom. And it was that day in the library that I began to wonder how many other people were out there fighting an invisible battle against sleep or sleepiness, thinking that they just weren't strong enough for their schoolwork or their careers. And how do we create a culture where a serious, biologically driven neurological condition like narcolepsy could blend in as since everyone was tired. When did being tired become so trendy anyway? So these were really the questions that fueled my passion for sleep advocacy. I like to say that first I got angry and then I got academic. So once I had this kind of passion and this fierce determination to better understand this field, I studied rare disease drug development and looking at the incentives and barriers to developing new treatments. I remember listening to Dr. Demenz, The Promise of Sleep, in an audiobook and crying with feeling like I had, you know, found like my tribe. I remember reading the IOM report on sleep loss and sleep disorders, which became like a Bible and a roadmap for the kind of change I wanted to see. After graduating from law school, I moved to Washington, D.C., where I worked on writing my memoir, and I got involved with anything and everything I could. I just basically started showing up at a lot of meetings. I remember one in particular, standing in the back and watching Phyllis present at the U.S. Capitol. And I just kind of felt like a super fan. And eventually, you know, had the honor of serving on the NIH's Sleep Disorders Research Advisory Board. And after spending a few years in the space and getting to know the different organizations, I did feel like there was an unmet need for a patient-driven organization dedicated to raising awareness about sleep health and sleep disorders. And so founded Project Sleep in 2013. And in 2017, it was when the Sleep Research Society reached out to see how we might partner on sleep advocacy, which was still to this day one of the greatest things that has ever happened to me, and certainly it's ever happened to Project Sleep. And I really want to credit the Sleep Research Society for recognizing the power of partnering with patient advocates and other key organizations to spur greater progress. So in thinking about how this event came about, we were planning an APSS sleep meeting presentation last year, about this time probably. And I remember we were trying to put together a panel about sleep advocacy. And once we started, you know, we thought it was a great idea, but as we started working on that panel, we realized that there was really so much you could do with the panel. And I remember joking that we could spend a whole day on sleep advocacy. Wouldn't that be nice? And I was joking at the time. But soon thereafter, I was speaking with our health experts at the Health and Medicine Council. And they mentioned that in other disease areas, that they had seen success in a centralized annual educational event to bring all stakeholders together. It seemed like a possible great fit for where we were in the sleep community, and that it seemed possible that Project Sleep could be a potential good fit to help facilitate this. So to be honest, putting all this together is a little bit intimidating for me, especially with so many of my role models and heroes and cheeros that we'll be presenting and sharing today. But if you know me, if I believe in something, you'll know that being scared won't stop me from taking action. And so I'm here a little bit scared to lead this effort today. And while Project Sleep is honored to facilitate this, this is really not about Project Sleep. It's about all of us. And it will only be successful when we all come together to elevate and strengthen the sleep field's collective efforts. So I want to thank our sponsors today. I can't thank Jazz Pharmaceuticals, Harmony Biosciences, Avidel, and Takeda for believing in the power of what it would mean to bring this sleep community together and make sure that we were elevating us on the national policy stage. It you know, really, really means the world, and we can't thank them enough for believing in this effort. So I really wanna say that we already have some amazing collaboration in this community, and I just wanna give a few quick examples of the amazing momentum that we've already started establishing. Just a few quick examples, and I'm sure we'll hear many more, but the Healthy School Start Times bill that was, I think it was almost 1 year ago, it was on October 13th last year that Governor Newsom signed the Healthy School Start Times bill into law. And this was a huge team effort led by Start School Later and many other groups and people that are with us today. And that was really the first state bill of its kind, and just a huge congratulations to them on getting this passed. We also had the annual appropriations sign-on letter that SRS and Project Sleep have been co-leading the last couple of years. And the first year we did this in 2019, thanks to patient advocates and researchers and organizations, different societies, we were able to get 31 members of the House of Representatives signed on to that letter. And we were really pretty pleased with that. We had a goal of getting 20 representatives signed on, and we exceeded our goal to get 31. Well, that was 2019. And in 2020, we were actually able to get 41 members of the House of Representatives, which is almost 10% of the entire House, to sign onto a letter that spoke to the priorities of the sleep community. And that's because of people like you. So the momentum is really growing. And I just want to mention that a lot of what we're doing in the US is sparking a lot of other international collaborations. And we just finished World Narcolepsy Day. So I just wanted to share that we have our friends in Brazil who are now working clinicians with patient advocates to fight for more rights for people with narcolepsy there, who do not have some of the same work accommodations and school accommodations in place yet in their country. And we have our friends in Australia who have been working on bringing treatment options, and also in Italy, where they're doing new ways of delivering care to patients, all patient organizations working with clinicians and researchers. And I just think that's really, really cool to see all those great collaborations. So I guess I have forgotten to mention the elephant in the room, that of course this is an extremely busy and challenging year. And so I really want to thank you all for showing up. I think by showing up that you've shown that you believe, like me, that sleep matters and that progress is still possible, even in a very challenging climate where everything seems a little polarizing and political and a little bit disheartening at times. I know when I feel disheartened, I return to sleep advocacy and this community as a welcome focus, because truly sleep touches all of us. And as our wonderful partner in DC, Dane Christensen, always reminds us, with the sleep world, our only opposition is lack of awareness. And that's a battle I am willing to fight.